Hello everyone, welcome to Archaeology. In this session, we are going to learn about the theory of the coal formation and the factor which is affected the formation of coal. But before we go ahead, please do like, share and subscribe my channel. So let's begin. Formation and origin of the coal. As we know, the coal is vegetal in nature. It is vegetal in origin, which is accepted in 1825. It is generally accepted that the coal generated from the plant's debris. It means जो कोयला है coal वो form होते हैं जो plants के debris material होते हैं like including fern, trees, bark, leaf, root and the seed. This is all the parts of the plant. Here you can see this is the tree having leaves, spores, and this is here roots, bark, and this is all parts of the plants which is accumulated or settle in the swamp. Slowly ye decompose hote hain aur settle down hote hain swamp mein. और आफ्टर अ मिलियंस ईयर दिस प्लांट्स बॉडी और दिस पार्ट्स ऑफ द प्लांट्स कन्वर्टेड इन टू पीट. सो हियर दिस इज द अनकंसोलिडेटेड एक्यूमुलेशन ऑफ द प्लांट्स रिमेन्स इज कॉल्ड पीट. सो पीट इज द पोरस इन नेचर. इट इज स्पॉन्जी इन नेचर ऑल्सो. स्पॉन्जी इन नेचर. दिस इज नॉट अ ट्रू कोल. ये ट्रू कोल नहीं है. दिस इज you can say this is the precursor. This is the precursor for the transformation of the true coal. So pehle peat banega, then lignite, then subbituminous, after then it's alter with bituminous, and then last product is anthracite, which is caused by the high temperature and the high pressure which is causes peat formation to the coal. So here the two theories which is given, first is in situ theory and second is drift theory. Now the factors that determine the formation of the coal, or you can say the condition or the environment which is necessary for the transformation of peat, lignite, bituminous to the coal, to the anthracite. So till now there is no doubt that coal is in vegetal origin and it's derived from the vegetal part of the plant. So there are two kinds of the vegetation. First is higher vegetation, second one is lower vegetation. So higher vegetations include herbs, shrubs and trees. These all are growing on the plains, plateau and mountains region. These are having wood tissue and they are rich in cellulose and lignin, and these cellulose and lignin is mother substance of the coal. Basically they are formed humic coal having banded in natures. They are banded. So now second one is the lower vegetation, which is mainly composed of the planktonic algae. Planktonic algae and some aquatic plants. So basically these are formed under the lake or the bottom of the lake, sea and submerged under the water, which is basically formed after the transformation sapropelic coal. These are non-banded in nature. So there are many questions which is raised in your mind. So first question is how and where these vegetal matters got accumulated. So according to this figure you can understand. So around 300 million year ago, there was a period called Carboniferous period. At that time, there is a dense forest and huge trees are present at that time. And they were grow low-lying area and wetland area, which is having swampy environment. Swampy environment means daldal. There are lots of water. There are sufficient amount of water, which is good for the formation of the coal. When these dense trees and forests dead and buried under the swamp, means वो दलदल में दबते गए, जैसे जितने भी forest थे, जब वो buried हुए, death हुई उनकी, तो वो दलदल में दब गए. And after millions of the time, when this partial decaying matters of the coal, of the plants were covered with waters and the layer of the dust, which just the block the atmospheric connection with this partial decaying matters to the atmosphere, and this create anaerobic condition. When this get buried deeper and deeper, the anaerobic thermal degradations of the material take place, and after again millions of the time. So this is the coal bed which is deposited at the deeper depth due to this overburden pressure, which is causes due to this sediments load. This is the strata of the sediments which is deposited over a time, which causes high temperature and high pressure. Due to this high temperature and high pressures, there are the physical and chemical changes take place in this coal, and this coal becoming the high grade of the coal, and there is mature stage, and this is rich in the carbon. This is rich in carbon percentage, and the concentration of the hydrogen, nitrogen and oxygen is going to be decreases, and also ash percentage and the moisture content is also decreases. So now we understand the factor which is very important for the coal formations. So first we need swampy area or lots of water. Second we need rapid burial, and third we need high temperature and high pressure. So let's understand the main topic of this video, which is in situ theory, which is also known as the autochthonous theory of the coal formation. So according to this theory, the coal seams are observed where once the forest grew, means a million year ago जहाँ पे forest हुआ करते थे, आज वहीं हमें coal seams मिल रही हैं. So this is called as the autochthonous. So autochthonous means the origin and the deposition are both taking at the same place, means the site is the same. जहाँ origin, deposition और coal का transformation होता है at the same place is known as autochthonous or in situ theory. So ये हुआ कैसे, let's see. The formation of the coal period, which is known as the Carboniferous period, at that time there was number of trees or forest. When submerged under the water, suppose this is the whole forest, when this whole forest land was sinking slowly and accumulated all vegetation matters under the water, and after a course of the time the rate of sinking of this land was increased. So suppose this is the whole forest when submerged under the water, and after millions of the time the sedimentations take place, and this is the another layer of the sediment, and again the forest grew. This is the whole forest trees, and this again submerged under the water, and again sedimentation take place. So this is the coal, after a transformation this form a coal seam or coal bed. So this is the number one, and this is coal bed two, coal seams, and this process taking place again and again, and after transformation this form the coal beds, and this is the other sedimentary strata you can say, and this is another sedimentary
sorry, coal seam bed, and this is another sedimentary strata. So there are some evidence through which we can identify this is the in-situ theory or drift theory. So these are the some evidence, according to them we can identify. So let's see one by one. So the first point is the upright fossils tree trunk V-gate. So as I told you, in in-situ theory, the original position or the original deposition is take place at the same place. So this is the tree trunk, which is transformed into the coal due to overburden pressure of this sedimentary strata. This is the sedimentary strata and this is the coal seam. So due to overburden pressure, so the tree trunk, which is nearly upright or vertical in nature, or fossils root in the coal seams V-gate. So this is the original position of the forest, which is transformed into coal. So it's having remnant of the fossils root. So at the bottom of the coal seams we get root, which is attached to this tree trunk. So this is the root of this tree trunk. So next, uniform thickness and homogeneity or constant in the composition of the coal. So there is, as we know, in situ theory there is no transportation or there is no extra material which is combined in this coal seam. So there is homogeneity, means constant in composition, there is no variation in this composition. So general, there is absence of detrital material. Again, there is no contaminations, no transportations take place, so there is no detrital material and sand or clay in the coal seams. So this is, here impurity is very less, there is no contaminations, there is constant in composition. So third, the ash percentage is quite low. So what is ash? If we burn the coal, the residue material which is left, that is known as ash. So ash is non-combustible inorganic residue which is left after the burning of the coal. So there is no inorganic substance present in this coal seam, so there is less inorganic material. That's why there is the percentage of the ash is quite low. So relative less mineral matter is also present. There is no contamination, no transportations of the coal seams. That's why there is a less in mineral matter. So the second theory is the drift theory, which is also known as the Olapthonos theory. It means, as the name suggests, drift means there should be transportation. So the source or the origin and depositions are both at the different places. So the site is the different. In this figure you can see, this is the original position of the terrestrial plants and this is the depositional slide. This is depositional slide. So let's see how. So the first is, the coal is formed largely from the terrestrial plants material growing on the dry land. This is the different. In the in-situ theory, the plants material growing in the swamp area deposited at the same place. But here, the plants material is growing on the dry land, not in the swampy area. And the original plants debris was transported by the waters and deposited under the water, lake or in the sea. So you can see here, this is the original positions of the terrestrial plants material. Suppose there were heavily rainfalls, right? So due to this, there is the soil becomes loosened. Soil become loose, that's why the whole forest material fell down and accumulated here. So these are fell down along the slopes, or you can say there may be landslides, right? So these materials are fell down and deposited in the lake, sea or in basin area. So after the course of the time, they were covered with this huge layer of the soil, or you can say dust. So due to this, there is some physical chemical changes take place and this material going to be transported into the coal. So this is how in the drift theory the original plant's material is going to be transported through the slope and deposited here. So the source or the origin of the plant's material and deposition sites is the different. So there are some evidence according to them we can identify whether this coal seam belonging to the drift theory or in in-situ theory. So let's see. So the first evidence is upright tree trunk is absent. This is the very important point. This is the one of the main features according to them we can identify. So in the in-situ theory, the original position of the tree is as it is, means they are upright, they are in original position, while in the drift theory the tree trunks is not in upright, they are should be inclined or somehow they are horizontal in natures. Due to this transportation from the pro long distance, they should be horizontal or inclined. In in-situ theory, there is the remnant of their roots because they are attached to the soil. But in the drift theory, they are traveled from a long distance, so they are inclined in nature or horizontal in nature. Second, the wide variation in the composition. Again, due to this transportation, there is a variation, there is some extra material which is adding here. So there is wide variation in composition as compared to the in-situ. So the ash content is high. Here ash content is high, while in in-situ theory the ash content is low. This is because the minerals matter is quite high here. That's why the ash percent is also high. The coal bands are not uniform. The coal seams is lie directly over the sandstone, shales and conglomerate. While in the in-situ theory, the coal seams were directly over the soil because they are attached with the soil, but here they are transported from the prolonged distance and deposited here on the any sedimentary rock. So this is very important that Gondwana coal is generally formed from the drift theory. So this is how we can identify the by looking the coal seams whether it is formed from the drift theory or they are belong to the in-situ theory. So that's all for today. Thank you guys for watching this video.